There's this parlor game that we play, What Unites India. This is particularly relevant given Vikram's other book. And usual answer is food. We all love food. We all love cricket. We all love Bollywood. I disagree with that. I don't watch much cricket. But I think we all love history. We all love people who break the mold, like these women have. And we all love music. So it is my privilege to be the moderator of this session. And we are going to kick it off with a video that sort of provides the context of what we will see this evening. After that, I will invite Kiran to give the say a few words, inaugural address about the book, and then we'll have a panel discussion. So that's how it will be. Trailer video one. Invite on stage the author producers Vikram Sampath and Ricky Cage, and I also invite Kiran Majumdar Shah to give the
so first and foremost you know, it's great being at a book launch, I mean in person, because I think we are all so used to virtual launches and virtual meetings, and this is the first time I'm actually coming for a book launch in person, so it feels great. So thank you so much for having it here, and of course I do feel that you know, we all have to start getting back to normalcy, especially if we are all vaccinated. And I think I want the paranoia to kind of reduce, because although we must mask up, I do believe that if we can focus on vaccination, I think we will be able to get back to some semblance of normalcy. So let's start celebrating that sense of normalcy with this great book launch. So I want to tell you a little anecdote. You know, of course, I've known Vikram for many, many years, and I've always admired his works, because I really think he's a great historian. And the way he comes out with the historical narrative is so interesting that you just get riveted to all of his books. So, of course, you know, when he sort of shared with me his latest, this coffee table book, which to me was like a coffee table book, I said, oh, you know, Women of the Records. And I thought, oh, thanks a lot, Vikram. And I thought, I'm just going to gloss over it, you know, just flick the pages and it looks nice and glossy. But, you know, I started reading it and I said, wow, I didn't know half of what I was reading in that book. And I must share another part of me which many of you don't know. I'm a trained Indian classical singer. So, you know, I started reading about Gauhar Jan. And that is what really gripped me. I said, wow, you know, look at these women. And, you know, I could then sort of resonate with these very strong, I felt they were very entrepreneurial women. They were very daring women. And they were women of substance, because these were women who had broken the mold. They were, you know, they were actually wrapped in a very conservative society, and yet they had the brevity of, you know, sort of breaking out of those societal mindsets and showing to these societies what women are all about. They had actually broken the gender barrier, according to me. Okay, all these women singers, starting with Gauhar Jal. I really urge every one of you to buy this book and read it. It's fabulously written. It's inspiring for every woman who reads it. It's also very inspiring for men who are liberated men, because I really think these women, you know, especially starting with Gauhar Jan, who actually experimented with the gramophone company in recording her music, because imagine the men felt that, oh my God, we lose our voices if we record our voices. And here was this woman who said, wow, I can, you know, spread my fame worldwide because this gramophone will travel. Look at the way she thought. She could immediately understand what this technology was all about. So, Mohan, women can understand technology and use it. Okay. The other thing that really, you know, jumped at me was every one of these women have had to brave the odds. They have challenged, you know, societal mindsets. They've said, and you know, all these women are educated women. Because I don't know many of you if you know it, but these are women who actually, unlike the high society women who were never educated, who were kept at home, taught all the domestic skills, these women had to fend for themselves. So they were actually poets. They were right. They knew how to write, they knew how to read, they knew how to sing, they knew how to dance, and they knew all these kind of basic skills. So they were educated women. We have never looked at them as educated women. And then on top of being educated, they were stars, they were performers. They had the courage, they had the persona, they had the presence to perform in front of thousands of people. I mean, this Gauhar Jan, I was just amazed at the way she would come in her, you know, almost like one, her, I think she used to take on the British in terms of coming with her great... in pomp and splendor, right? She had her own little carriage and all the people. I mean, you should read this book, so I don't want to give away too much. But, you know, I was also struck by the fact that, you know, there are so many myths about women. They always say women are not daring, they are not risk-taking, they are not ambitious, you know, they are very subservient. But all these women have actually busted every one of those myths. So right from... Gauhar Jan, who was a very strong woman, right up to, you know, Subbulakshmi and, you know, Gangubai Hangal, and all the ones you know about, it has been mentioned in the book and what their backgrounds were. And many of you might have known that even Subbulakshmi was a very daring woman, very defiant woman. And so it's very interesting to read this book, because every one of these, you know, singers, these female singers, is an iconic singer. And it's a pity that it hasn't been archived the way it should be. So I want to congratulate Vikram, and of course Ricky deserves a huge amount of congratulations because he is Vikram's partner in crime. So I just want to congratulate both of them for coming out with this book. And it is really the next best thing to at least archiving this piece of history. Because I think it's so important to celebrate our history. Celebrate our culture, celebrate our women. You know, women are never celebrated. I mean, I always feel that somehow, even in today, in 21st century India, we still don't celebrate strong women. I mean, today someone sent me a WhatsApp of me being on a list of 50 great people, you know, people in India or some influencers in India. I was shocked to see how few women there are in that list. It's always the old male suspects. They don't call out women. And I'm also an old suspect. I'm the only sort of boring old one face comes out, you know, with a few new faces. I really want, there are so many women who are doing wonderful things in this country, but they are never called out. I think the press is also very guilty of just focusing on the same old set of people. That's why I always tell people, please don't keep on, you know, paying these accolades to me, because there are many smarter women than me who need to also be recognized. So I just feel these singers whom we are recognizing are really great women. and we must celebrate them. We must celebrate our culture, we must celebrate our music, we must celebrate our women, and we must celebrate these women especially because of the odds that they have faced. And they have come up on top. And, you know, of course, Subbalakshmi is a Bharat Ratna, but many of the other women also were worthy of such titles. So I'm just saying that we must, you know, read this book for what it's all about, for what history represents. And I want to again take this opportunity of congratulating Vikram. Vikram is a great history writer. I'm sure many of you have written or read all his other books. I always, you know, meticulously go through his writings because he does a lot of research. Even with Gauhar Jaan, I was very, very impressed with the way he followed her life right up to trying to find her grave in Mysore. Okay? But I won't let it out what happened. But I just want you to know that he's one of those kind of researchers who will not leave any stone unturned. I know, Aditi, you said that he was a student of yours, so I'm sure you're very proud of him.
Extremely.
We are very proud of him because he's a product of Namma Bengaluru. And I wish you all the best. I think it's a great book for everybody to read for the reasons I talked about. And I'm really happy to launch it today. Thank you.
So, Kiran, why don't you?
She told me that it was very easy to open.
We don't know which.
But we don't know which one goes where.
Weak there point. There
I'll share it with Michael.
Yeah. You can all hold it up a little higher.
You know, when I was reading the book and preparing for this session, it's a lot of words came up which started with C, which was curiosity, contribution, challenge. So that's the ethos of what we are going to discuss. Let me start with Vikram. And between Ricky and Vikram, they've decided that Vikram is the anchor to the past and Ricky is sort of the catapult to the future. So Vikram, talk to us about these women, because for people who haven't yet read the book, why should we care? Why are they important?
Very good evening, everyone. And it's really a great moment for the three of us, Ricky, Michael, and me. We've been working very hard on this project for several years now, I think, to put this together. And very delighted that all of you have come here to share our joy on this very significant occasion. Deeply thankful to Kiran for your kind words and also for giving the foreword to the book. I think it came as a surprise to me too when she said she was trained in the Agra Gharana, Agra Gharana of Hindustani classical music. So there are facets to a person we don't even know of. Who would even imagine that the MD of Biocon would actually have this sensitive side to herself of being a trained Hindustani vocalist. There are also several people in the audience who, I'm very, very emotional seeing many of them. One is, of course, Mr. Mohandas Pai here, thanks to whom this Archive of Indian Music project, which facilitated this entire Women of the Records, came about. I had gone up to him in despair, like I do several times, and he said, don't worry, don't go behind, you know, all these sterile governments and their departments, and nothing is going to happen. So when I was actually, you know, as a visiting fellow in Berlin, I managed to visit several of these national sound archives in different parts of Europe, Vienna, Paris, Berlin, and London. And two things struck me there. One was almost all of them had a national sound archive and also huge holdings of Indian records, not necessarily only of music, but also voices of the past. For instance, there was this one archive in Berlin called the Laut Archive, which had almost about 200 records of Indian prisoners of war, of the First World War, you know, talking in their native languages from Bengali, Tamil, Pashto, Sindhi, and all of that. And Germans being Germans, for every 3-minute recording, there was a 40-page documentation about who this fellow was and what he was talking, which village he came from, what was his father's name, the kissa kahani they were asked to narrate. You know, all that was, you know, transliterated into German, translated into from German to, from the native language to German. And the one question they all asked me was, doesn't India have a national sound archive? So as a student of music and student of history, and more importantly as an Indian, it was deeply embarrassing to say that we do not have one such institution. So most of the records, you know, lie scattered, especially of the 78 RPM era, in chor bazaars, in raddi shops, in flea markets and shanties, uncared for, undocumented, and nobody really cares. This is a part of our cultural inheritance, as probably for the whole of humanity, but we really don't care documenting it. So that was when, on coming back, I tried to establish, this is 2011, and that's when I tried to establish something with the government that never worked out, and that's when Mr. Pai was my, you know, angel for a person who was in distress, and he said, you set it up, and within the Manipal group, we established this archive. And when I discussed this with Ricky, we thought it was a very compelling story, because interestingly, when recording technology came to India, and all the women in this room, a big shout out, because when recording technology came to India, the men folk stayed away largely. And it was largely women across north, south, east, west of India who embraced this technology. They had something, this chutzpah in them, that despite all the superstitions that did the rounds, as Kiran said, you know, that you would lose your voice or the gods would be displeased and all of that, disregarding all these, you know, superstitions and a lot of logistic challenges that they faced, because as was mentioned even in the trailer, these records were only of 3 minutes duration, and in that very limited capsule, you had to present something as expansive as Indian classical music, which where a raga can be improvised all through the night. To have a capsulated form of that, like you know, like pressy writing in literature, where just in 3 minutes you give the essence of the form and also don't compromise on the aesthetics and the grammar of the music itself. So that was a huge challenge, and probably that's what kept the men away, saying it's a compromise on classicism. Also, there was the other challenge of technology, where, you know, you didn't have microphones to amplify your voice. It was the acoustic era, where there used to be a horn fitted on the wall, and the singer had to crane her head inside that horn and scream out as loudly as they could. And depending on how loudly they screamed, there was a stylus on the other end which would vibrate and cut etches on the shellac disc. Now, Indian musicians, as you know, classical musicians, while singing, they would tend to move their head and hand as the raga overtakes them. And that would, you know, spoil the quality, the acoustic energy that would go inside. So there would be two agents who would hold your hand, one would hold your head and push them into that, you know, horn and say, bellow hard. So some of the records you'll hear, they're in high-pitched, shrill recordings, which may not seem very palatable to our technologically trained ear today, with iPods and all the other things that have come about. But then, had these women not taken that step in 1902, when the gramophone company came to India, Indian music industry would not have been where it is today. And most of these women belong to the Tawaif and the Devdasi background, courtesans. And very conveniently, as all men would do, for 10 years, 15 years, they all stayed away. Then they saw the, you know, the recognition, more importantly, the money that this new technology brought. And after 15 years or 20 years, they conveniently entered the space. And luckily for them, by then, electrical recording technology had come about. Microphones could amplify your voice. Most of these women were then displaced as common prostitutes. The infamous anti-Notch campaign that was launched against them. So their very, very conscious attempts were made to obliterate their stories from national consciousness, from musical consciousness, and also attempts to standardize music so that it didn't sound like her. Very clearly, compositions were sanitized, obscene and erotic words removed from tumris and dadras and padams and javlis, both in Hindustani and Carnatic music, so that music could become safer for middle class boys and girls to learn in families, respected families, while it did a lot to the music and made it come out into a larger space. It was literally throwing the baby out with the bathwater, where the actual holders of this tradition, an entire group of them, were ostracized and cut off with no efforts made for rehabilitation parallel careers. Many of them died either in penury or resorted to flesh trade, or some of them again reinvented themselves, went on to Bombay cinema, Tamil cinema, and people like Nargis's mother, Jaddan Bai, and so many others belong to this background where they were constant innovators. Every time a challenge came to them, they knew how to circumvent it. A new technology comes, they know how to circumvent that. How to negotiate with a white man, the rates of a recording session. Gauhar Jaan used to charge something like 3,000 rupees, 5,000 rupees for one recording session. So that also, and when all attempts to malign and obliterate them, then again a reinvention to become a new, enter the cinema, use those skills of, as Kiran mentioned, poetry and music and dance and all of that to reinvent themselves. So I think this project, Shobha, is as much a tribute to the ingenuity and the grit of these women as also to the eternal human spirit that would never, be subdued, be whatever we're seeing today. I think the human spirit is constantly fighting against the pandemic, against everything. I think this is one in that same series where we need to acknowledge that beyond all these odds, how did these people actually etch their voices for posterity? We may not care about them, we may not know their stories, but their voices are so eloquently screaming out their stories, waiting to be heard, as Gauhar Jaan finishes all her records with, "My name is Gauhar Jaan." So, stamping your authority and saying, "This is my copyright. Nobody can take this away from me. You may disrespect me, but my music will speak for me."
So there are four clips. So may we have the first clip, video two. So Sohini is Raga Hamsa Nandi in Carnatic music, yeah. And there's a very famous old song called Kuhu Kuhu Bole Koeliya, and that is in this ragam. But what Vikram says, so I'm going to ask Ricky about documentation and how it applies to the music that he composes and works with. And I'm going to talk to Kiran about how she's a woman of science as well, and why is this Indian fear of documenting. And Michael, of course, I will come to. But I wanted to just mention that Indians have a deep suspicion of being documented. We like being documented in sculptures and epigraphy. But even today, if you go to a village and try to photograph people, they'll say no, because the ayus will go down. So we like Shruti literature. We like memorizing. But we don't like written stuff. We don't like putting it on a gramophone. But you work on the other end of the spectrum and talk about compression, talk about 3 minutes. How did you masterfully produce this?
So, first of all, thank you everybody for showing up. Means a lot, especially during these times. And very grateful to Vikram for this collaboration. I think it's one of the greatest collaborations I've ever done in my life. So thank you so much. Now, when it comes to these, first, I wanted to say something else. While Kiran was speaking, I was just thinking in my mind that this panel itself needs to be celebrated, your panel, Shobha, because if you had to speak about this panel and say that, you know, that there's a billionaire biotechnologist and two artists, you would think that, you know, the billionaire biotechnologist is actually a man, you know, and the two artists are women. But in this particular case, it is the opposite. So, I mean, it's amazing. And that billionaire biotechnologist is also, a trained Hindustani classical musician. So that's absolutely amazing. So I think a big round of applause to Kiran. And so when it comes to these recordings itself, what really got me to these recordings when, Vikram showed me these shellacs and these particular records was that, you know, that these recordings were absolutely pure. And you just heard a small excerpt from Goharjan's recording. These recordings are absolutely pure, first of all, because this was before pop music and Bollywood music entered India. So basically, the Hindustani classical music is actually Hindustani classical music when it's recorded, even though it's in a short form, but it is in its purest form. Now, when it comes to recording technology nowadays, when you have a singer come into the studio, even in my studio or any other studio, there are a few things that we do with the voice, and I'm just going to quickly explain to you what we do with the voice. Number one is that by default, even if a singer does not admit to it and says that, no, I don't use it, everybody uses some form of pitch correction. Whether it is autotune or whether it's Melodyne or whether it is Waves Correct or Waves Tune, or there are tons and tons of these softwares, but everybody uses some form of a pitch correction software. So this basically, you can define a scale on your software, and what that particular software will do is that it will ensure that that the voice does not go out of that scale. And it corrects it, or you can go minutely and you can correct a few points here and there and you can make the voice perfect. The second thing that that is done is that we correct something known as the dynamics. Now what the dynamics does is that the dynamics, sometimes, you know, the voice is soft in a certain place because you're singing with a lot of emotion, and sometimes the voice is loud in certain places because you're belting it out and you're singing with a lot of passion. Now the thing is that you cannot sing the softer parts loud because you're going to lose the emotion. So what you do is that you sing it softly, but then you get the software to pull up the volume, and that's what the dynamics do. Like for example, a whisper, even if you turn up the volume to like 10 on your music system, a whisper is going to sound like a whisper, right? Whether you put it at a volume of 1 out of 10 or you put it at 10 out of 10, it's going to sound like a whisper because that is the way that it has been recorded. So, but sometimes you want the whisper to be heard really well. So that is why you basically turn up the volume of a whisper. So that's what the dynamics does to a recording, that you basically dial in the dynamics so that every nuance of the particular song is heard properly. Then you do something known as processing. So with processing, what you do is that you do the equalization where you if you want to add some more warmth to the voice, you add some more bass to it. And if you want to add a little more depth to the voice, you add a little bit in the mid frequencies. If you want to add more presence to the voice, and if you want the voice to be heard more clearly, like in most pop music, then you would add a lot of high frequencies to it. So like in all A.R. Rahman songs, you hear that the voices have got a lot of high frequencies in it. So that's the way it is. So you actually process the voice in that way. And then a lot of people who are singers, like, you know, at home, you know, sort of like hobbyist singers, you love singing in a bathroom, right? Because it's, your voice sounds really good in a bathroom because of all the echo and all the reflections and things like that. So that's basically reverberation, because you've got flat surfaces in the bathroom, you've got hard stone surfaces and tile surfaces. So everything reverberates a lot, and it's the same thing in places of worship, like you know, temples and mosques and you know, in churches. The voice sounds much better in these places because of the acoustics. So you can actually replicate that in your recording, and everybody does that. We add some amount of reverberation or echo to make the sound more impressive. And the last thing is editing. Now, very rarely you find a singer who just comes into the studio and sings the whole song in one shot, you know? So what they do is that they usually take multiple takes of the song, and then a sound engineer comes in or a producer comes in and takes like the best parts of each of the takes and puts that together, and that's known as comping of a take. It's pretty much making a Frankenstein take out of many takes. Or what they do is that they take every single part separately, like every line separately, till they get it perfect, and they move on to the rest of the song. Now, all these things were not available to these singers in this particular project. So to imagine, this is the purest form of music where all these singers just had one take to do it. And basically, that's all that we hear. We don't hear any. And of course, Michael is going to explain to you about the process of restoring these recordings. But Michael just faithfully restored it. He did not add anything to it to embellish the voices or to make the voices sound better. This is exactly what it is. And it's amazing that this is basically pretty much the oldest records that we have of Indian classical music. And and I would go on to saying that this is the best records that we have till date of Indian classical music, and I think everybody needs to appreciate it. So that's basically what I would say from... Okay, so that's what... And Michael, I guess, will explain about all the aspects of it.
Sure. Hi, Michael. I'm Shobha.
Hi, nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you. So between Dua Lipa, Camila Cabello, you're listening to Gauhar Jaan. What does it sound like to you? And can you explain the process of how you made it sound... I don't want to say better, but made it sound like how we
improved from the, well.
Yeah, was it like?
My specialty is working with historic recordings. So about 20 years ago, I started really as a hobby. I had a large record collection, and I like the, this is about the mid to late 1990s, and I like the idea of digitizing my records. And as soon as you digitize a record, you realize that the surface noise is there, and it becomes much more prominent than if you just dropped a needle on a record and listened to it, you know, just casually. Because those, if there's a pop at 30 seconds in on a digitized recording, it's going to be there forever. So in essence, you sort of mix that surface noise with the music, and the surface noise really has no business being part of that mix. So what I try to do is separate the performance from the medium that it's recorded on. And when I first started doing this, it was a hobby. And I was living in Atlanta, Georgia at the time, and there was a record label there called Dust to Digital. And they specialized in releasing these old 78 RPM recordings. So we joined forces, and I've done all their projects ever since then, and it's been a really great relationship. But this is sort of, this has become my specialty, is working with these old historic recordings. So when Ricky and Vikram came in with this project, I was right up my alley. So I was really looking forward to working with it. And I think when we think of audio restoration, if you think anything about it, you probably don't, but we think of the wonderful digital tools that we have. So there's wonderful like things in the computer that can de-click and de-crackle and denoise and all these things. And they're outstanding. But equally important is what happens before the record is digitized. There's a lot of restoration that has to happen in the analog world. And the most important thing is, and it sounds so simple, is just making sure the record is clean before you played it. The second thing, using the right needle. And there's a lot of different needles that you can choose that can help reduce the noise. So when I talked about this with Ricky and Vikram, I said some of these records had already been digitized. And it makes my job more difficult to work with something that's been digitized that, like, maybe an incorrect needle was chosen, or maybe that's all the person had. So long story short, We all decided to send all these records. I think we FedExed them right to Atlanta. We got about 30 or 40 78 records, and nothing broke. These shellac records are very fragile. There's no bending them. You can bend it just a little bit, and snap, it's gone. So everything arrived safely. My wife, Joy, does all of our transfers. She digitizes everything. So she transferred all the records. And then I started doing my work on them. And so restoration, when we get into the digital world of restoration, when you first start playing with some of these tools that can remove the noise, it's very intoxicating. And it can lead you down a wrong path, because you can turn this noise down and you think, oh, the noise is gone, but listen to the music. The music is completely ruined. It sounds computery, plastic, underwater. So that's the balance that I have to walk every day of my job, is trying to remove that surface noise and connect the listener with the music as best as I can.
So what's your what do you aspire for? Is it the sound quality that people get when they listen to it live? Is that the aspiration? What
my goal is, and it really depends on the medium that it's recorded on. For 78s in particular, there's no way I'm going to be able to remove all the surface noise. It's just always going to be there. Because of the way Vikram explained, the way it was recorded, they're basically singing into a horn, and they're just trying to get as much emotion and everything into this horn.
Yeah.
And that right there creates noise, because there's noise there, but then there's also noise inherent in the 78 shellac record. Yeah. So what I try to do is just minimize the noise as much as I can, yeah, without hurting the music. And as soon as I start to hear the music change in a negative way, I stop. Yeah. And we'll just have to live with that noise, because this is the best we can do.
Yeah.
But there is one other thing we can do. If you think about the difference of noises, there's the pops and clicks that we all think of records. Those are pretty easy to remove. It's that underlying sound that's really difficult to get rid of. But a lot of times that changes, like it'll get louder and it's quieter. And if I can make that sound sort of consistent all the way through, your brain subtracts it much easier, and it doesn't jolt you out of the, you know, you might be really getting into this performance and all of a sudden this loud noise shows up and it sort of takes you out of the moment. I try to reduce that so that if there's going to be noise in the record, I try to make it a consistent noise.
Yeah. So I was told that it's really early for you and to give you an out. So we're going to be talking about the women, the characters of the book. So feel free,
sure,
to stay or log out as you wish.
But just okay, before Michael goes, I just wanted to give some context to Michael. Michael is considered to be the greatest audio restoration mastering engineer in the whole world. Wow. He will... He's too humble to speak about these things. And secondly, he has won 4 Grammy Awards for just doing this. So you can imagine that. So, and Michael, since we last met, have you won another one?
I did, yes. Last year,
it's 5, sorry, fortunate. Sorry. So that's the thing. So Michael is an amazing person. He's got one of the best studios, and he's really, really passionate about what he does. So we are extremely grateful that he took on this project, and he gave us his immense time to do this, and even to show up at 5 a.m. for his time zone. So thank you so much, Michael, for that.
Thank you.
I'm so glad we connected on this, and I'm so proud of this project. It really is amazing, and I hope a lot of people hear it and hear the story.
Thank you, Mike.
Thank you. So I'm going to, sorry, okay.
I am going to leave. Is that okay?
Okay.
All right, bye-bye.
So I'm going to ask Kiran about breaking the mold, and then we will have video 3, and then we'll do the next round. So Kiran, a lot of this book is about women who break the mold. So one way of asking this question is, what do you think these women like Gauhar Jan had that made them break the mold? And what advice would you give today's women who want to break the mold like these people?
So whenever you think about women who want to break the mold, it is really about proving something. It's about proving themselves. It's about taking on a challenge, fighting societal mindsets. I think that is very important, because I think it's also a survival instinct for them. That, you know, society looks at them a certain way. They've been wronged. There's been a lot of injustice. If you look at Gauhar Jan's story itself with her mother, you know, if you see, I don't want to talk too much about it, because they need to read it, okay? But I just want you to know that these were women who were literally abandoned, and then they had to sort of build up their own lives. So these are women who are strong, who built their lives. You know, Gauhar Jaan suddenly discovered herself. I think when you take on societal mindsets and you want to break the mold, you suddenly start believing in yourself. You start knowing how strong you are. You really start realizing that you can do things which you didn't think was possible. Mm-hmm. So that's when you break out of the mold and start building your own persona, so to speak. Mm-hmm. And I think that's what these women have done. Every one of them, you know, they've had to fight for themselves, fight for their rights, fight for their personas. Mm-hmm. You know, it started with, of course, and when you want to do that, you're willing to experiment. Mm. You're willing to, you know, take on new avenues. Mm. And I think that's why it makes them so innovative, creative, and entrepreneurial. Because after all, entrepreneurs do that. Mm. You know, you want to break the mold. You don't want to, you know, walk on the trodden path, right? Mm. You want to do something different. Mm. That's what Gauhar Jaan decided. If she had to break the mold and be, you know, show the men that she's as strong, if not more, if more powerful. Mm. She had to do something different.
Yeah, yeah.
And the men were so scared to try this new technology, and she must have seen this as, hey, if they are so scared to, you know, try out this new technology, this is an opportunity for me.
Yeah, yeah.
And let me take it on before they change their minds.
Correct.
You know, that sort of a thing. Yes,
yes. Yes. First movers advantage. But you have to. You both have to tell us about this. But we'll listen to video 3 next, and Vikram can talk about the injustices and today's injustices, Ricky. You know, Jayanti Kumaresh, who wields India's instrument, which is the Veena, once told me that she's a magnificent player, but she said the human voice can emote pathos, which is very hard for an instrument to compete with. So Vikram, you have wonderful stories in the book about the Tufan that came in Mysore and in Calcutta. What draws you to these women's spirit and the overcoming of it? And maybe you can say a few words about, I mean, you are very passionate about these, the underdog, so.
Yeah. Well, my first brush with this, though I've been a student of Carnatic music, of a student of Jayanti Kumaresh Akka herself and also Bombay Jayashree Akka. But, you know, I had no clue about these names. You know, in contemporary Carnatic and Hindustani music and musicians too, many of these names, Gauhar Jaan has become popular now, so everyone, you know, at least knows her. But then Janki Bai of Allahabad, Zohra Bai of Agra, Malka Jaan Agrewali, Bangalore Nagaratnamma from our own city, Salem Godavari, Noti Binodini in Calcutta, Achan Bai of Bombay.
Siddheshwari
Devi, of course, is the next era. Begum Akhtar, Siddheshwari Devi, M.L. Vasant Kumari, M.S. Subbalakshmi, all of them. But in the early eras, the first decade, these women, you know, Veena. Kali Jaan, Kitty Jaan, I mean, the names don't even, you know, have any recall in even musicians, you know, vocabulary. So my brush with Gauhar Jaan was very, very serendipitous when I was researching on the Mysore Wodeyar family, my first book, that though she was such a, you know, diva, the rock star, you know, as Kiran mentioned, who could give it back to everybody from the Viceroy to Mahatma Gandhi to some Datia's king, when the Maharaja of Datia invites her to sing, she says, this is too small a principality for me, I can't come there. And then, so she actually asks for, she puts up a high price, saying, you book an entire train for me. And the Maharaja actually does that, an entire train with 111 people, including horses, her horses, and Khan Sama, Bavarchi, the disciples, everybody going in that, this thing. So someone who was that kind of a pop star, the page three diva, dies in Mysore in 1930 as a visiting you know, guest of Nalvadi Krishnaraj Wodeyar, by when she has become so broken that she was literally selling her compositions for 1 rupee each, you know, to eke out a living. And she died a very, very sad, lonely death with nobody by her bedside to shed tears for her. And I saw those records, I mean, those papers, and somehow there was something that told me that this is a story waiting to be told. And had no clue how to do it, because it's literally like looking for a needle in a haystack. Because here's a Tawaif who died in our state in 1930 after staying here for 2 years. No legal heirs, obviously, no students, nothing. So over the next 4 years, it was literally chasing her through the length and breadth of India, from Azamgarh, where she was born, to Banaras, Rampur, Darbhanga, Calcutta, Madras, Bombay, all places where she had made some mark. Also Berlin, because the agent who came to record her was the first agent who came to India to record was a German man called Frederick William Gaisberg of the Gramophone Company. So he had some diaries which his family was very reluctant to give, which I managed to somehow get it from Berlin. Then London, there was, as Kiran rightly mentioned, most of these women were extremely erudite poets, you know, and Gauhar's mother, Badi Malka Jaan, she had written an entire Urdu Diwan called Magzane Ulfate Malika, or the treasure trove of Malka's love, in the 1880s. And I tried to look for it all over India, but it was not found in any of these, you know, Raza Library and Rampur and none of those places. And finally, the only copy of that was in London, in the British Library. We managed to get hold of that, which had brief biographical details about both Gauhar and her mother. And that is when I got to know about this whole story that, hey, I mean, we generally associate, as Ricky said, you know, men with tech and all of that. But when this technology came, how is it that women were the ones who were the pioneers? And why is it that their stories are not part of national and musical consciousness? Why have they been willfully suppressed? And that was how the trail began. And each of those, you know, stories is so fascinating in themselves. Gauhar Jaan sometimes is hugely overrated, though I've written her biography. But musically, Zohrabai was actually of Agra. Even the ustads of the Agra Gharana used to, like, literally get, you know, little bit of training here and there from her.
Yes.
And of course, they would never acknowledge this in public, that you actually took a little bit of tips from a woman.
Yes.
But this would always keep happening. And something like Khayal, she was supposed to be a master of Khayal singing, where in 3 minutes, if you noticed, I mean, we just played a minute. And in that 3 minute, a little bit of the alap, a little bit of sthai, antra, the mukhda, then a little bit of tans, you have to do a little bit of sargam, all of that in that capsulated form to give a glimpse to the listener.
And sound bites.
Sound bites, yeah, literally. And many of them were such high-browed tawaifs that for a common person to go to their concerts would be next to impossible. So what the gramophone did is also brought this music to the living room. They would be general, you know, community listening sessions, where people who could not afford the machine and the records, they would buy this, all of them sit around over adda and chai and then listen to these records. And it also, I think, somewhere removed the agency of the woman who was under, you know, a lot of derision.
Yes.
It was safe to listen to her without seeing her, you know. And that announcement, though there was a technical reason, so even Zohra Bhai announces, Mera Naam Zohra Bhai Agrawali, not as flamboyantly as Gohar does, but, you know, she also does that. There was a reason, because though the master shellac recordings were made in India, in different cities like Bombay, Madras, Calcutta and all that, they would be sent all the way to Hanover in Germany, where the technician would then listen to the whole recording. This would be an anonymous voice for him. He would listen to the whole recording, identify the singer by the announcement that she would make, and then multiple copies would be stamped with the name of it, of the artist put on it, and those records would then come back to India for sales. And then the very establishment, so much so that especially during the First World War years, when Europe was under so much of, bombings and all of that was going on, it was India which gave the gramophone company the mainstay. And that's why the gramophone company has stayed in India in different forms. Mm-hmm. It became HMV and Saregama and all these, His Master's Correct. Voice, which has always been around. Many other rival companies too, Pathé from France, Odeon from Germany, Lindstrom. So many record labels started coming to India, which was seen as this Sone Ki Chidiya there also, to record. And there too, these women, the beauty was, they said, we are not going to sign exclusive contracts. Yeah. It's not going to be only for gramophone company that I'm going to record. So Janki Bai simultaneously recorded for several other companies, as did Gohar and so many others. Yeah. So it was, I think, this, as I said in my opening remarks, this relentless human spirit of working against all odds, reinventing and making yourself relevant, and also making your art so much more relevant to people.
Yeah.
I think that was what drew me to all these stories.
Yeah, and all the Binaka Geet Mala that perhaps many of us listen to has a long narrative arc from what we just heard. But talk about today, Ricky. Is it, how do women fare in the musical universe of today?
So before that, I want to touch upon something that Vikram said about the limitation that these women had to perform an entire, piece of music in just 3 minutes. That has been a limitation that has existed since time immemorial right up to now. Because if you look at it, it's always the medium of recording which actually dictates your creativity. And I'll explain to you why. So previously, as Vikram said, it was between 3 to 4 minutes. That was how much you could record. So you have to fit in an entire classical piece, within 3 to 4 minutes. And of course, that's really difficult because, by the time a classical singer clears his or her throat, it's already 20 minutes, So basically, okay, jokes apart, I'm sorry about that. But what I'm saying is that, it was very difficult to actually fit that into 3 or 4 minutes. But if you look at the pop world had completely understood how to do that. In the Western world, they had completely understood how to fit compositions. Like a short intro, a first stanza, a chorus, a second stanza, a chorus, a quick bridge, and then the chorus at the end. So all the pop musicians understood this, and that's what started the whole concept of having a 3 to 4 minute track. That's what started that, because before that, before recording technology, pieces were always 10 minutes, 15 minutes, 40 minutes long, even in the Western world. Now what happened was that the LPs came out, and the LPs could afford about 23 minutes per side of good quality music. Of course, it could go longer than that if you could compromise on the quality. So then what happened is that multiple songs, because people do not want to stop that format of 3 to 4 minutes, so it became multiple songs on each side of the LP, and people could listen to more songs from the same artist. So that's what happened with the LPs. But then, in my opinion, the golden age of music happened with the cassette tape. Because what happened with the cassette tape was that you could do up to 45 minutes per side. And since the cassette tape does not allow you to skip tracks very easily. It's a little painful to go to right to the end of a particular track and go to the end of a particular track. People would listen to entire albums. And also with auto reverse, people could listen to 90 minutes of music continuously. So then people started making full-on albums, you know, and the whole, as I said, the golden era of the albums happened at that time because people could structure the albums of not putting the most powerful track in the beginning, but sort of like, you know, leaning you into the album in the first track and then, you know, going a little bit higher and you're maybe the best track comes in on number three. And then maybe right at the end, at the last track on side B, again, you have a really powerful track and you end with a bang because you trust that people are going to listen to the whole thing. You know, and then the CDs came in. CDs were also similar to cassettes. The only thing was that with CDs, you could skip tracks. So then that is where the decline of the album started. And of course, now with Spotify and streaming platforms, it's become the exact reversal because you would think logically that if there's digital distribution, then you could go to any length you want, which is true in some extent, to some extent. But the problem with Spotify is that the average listener, according to the statistics of Spotify, the average listener listens to 15 seconds of your music. That's all. So then basically, the meat of your song has to come in within the first 15 seconds. So gone are the days of having a long introduction and, you know, and leaning into a song, or like Guns N' Roses November Rain, where you have like a 3-minute introduction to a song. Those things were completely gone. So basically, every single pop song that you hear today, anywhere in the world, the chorus comes within the first 15 seconds. Your main hook line comes within the 15 seconds because they know that if the most interesting part of the song does not come in within the first 15 seconds, people are just going to skip through and they're never going to listen to the song again. And the way the Spotify algorithms work is that if a lot of people skip your song, then the song stops getting showcased to people in their home feeds. So that's the way that it works. So basically, even now we have that limitation, like when I make my music, I have to constantly think about that, you know, that is this first 15 seconds captivating enough for a person to listen to the music? So I understand what they went through, because at least for us, we can record a song and we can edit it and we can experiment, you know, what different lengths, and we can show different versions to different people. But for them, it was one recording that they could do. And in one take, they have to get it right within 3 minutes. And that was a huge, huge challenge, and it was very difficult for them. And then coming to women in the workplace, especially when it comes to music. Now, the biggest problem is that, in my opinion, and this is strictly my opinions, is that most women are in the entertainment side of the entertainment industry and not on the business side. And they're not in the managerial side, not in the production side. And this is not because women do not want to be there. It's because women are not accepted over there. And that is the problem, because men are in control and men want to hire men. Men want to hire people who they can smoke with, who they can drink with, who they can go partying out with, where there's zero controversy in the office. So that's the way it is. So when men or women or anybody, any gender, when any gender says that, you know, that quotas are not essential, you know, I feel that that comes from a sense of privilege. You know, because I think that the only way, and this is again strictly my opinion, so you can crucify me for this, but the only way for gender parity to come into and for, to make a safe working environment for women in the entertainment industry is to mandate proper quotas for women in managerial posts, in production posts, and in higher office posts. That's the only way it is going to happen.
That's great. So we have three brilliant recordings. So I'm going to play the next one, which is video 4, and then ask a 1-minute question to each of our panelists, and then it's already 7:10, so we'll take questions from the audience.
I'm
after this is MS Subbalakshmi, but Kiran and all three of you, if you don't mind very briefly. So you are a breaker of the mold and an enabler. Given what Ricky said and the quota system, how can companies in entertainment and otherwise be the enabler for women who want to break the mold?
I think what Ricky said is absolutely true. I think today, of course, there's a huge, you know, spotlight on DEI, as they call it, diversity, equity, and inclusion. And in that, I think gender is a very important part of that diversity and inclusion. And I think, this new sort of emphasis on ESG scoring is almost shaming companies into ensuring that they have gender equity and gender inclusion.
Yes.
And I think every company today is focused on how do they improve their gender ratio.
Mm.
So I think that's very good. I also have always told and he's absolutely right, men hire men because it's convenient, they're used to it, they hire people of their own ilk and their own behavioral habits, so it's very convenient. And also from the kind of controversies and issues that they have to deal with, they always feel it safer to hire men. That's another problem. So I always tell my people in HR, look, you know, there's this saying that all things being equal, the woman should be hired, which I don't agree with at all, because I said all things are not equal. So that's the first rule that is wrong. I always find a lot of people talk about this and I don't agree with that.
That's a great line.
So I always tell people, please hire women for their potential and men for their experience.
Mm.
And potential and experience should be on par.
Mm.
So this business of all things being equal, I don't agree with. So that's how I always
that's
have...
Great.
And also, if you start give incentivizing leadership and promotions based on how they're inducting women into their teams.
Yes.
I think that's another way of creating that kind of quota without really saying it's a quota.
Mm-hmm.
So I feel today, and they always say, oh, there are not enough women candidates, and that's wrong. Because suddenly when you say incentivize them with this,
yes,
you are finding very good women, you know.
Thank you.
And there are many, job types where there are lots of women candidates.
Mm.
So I think we need to really, you know, encourage it in that way.
Yeah. Can we listen to the Nightingale of India? I'm
so
going to ask Vikram.
Unhindered, different tonal quality to what MS we're usually used to. And also, if you could notice the difference in technology. This is a later 1925 to 40 compared to the earlier ones. The technology has become better. You can hear the accompanists a lot more.
Yeah.
Whereas in the earlier recordings, you could not. There's no more horns into which you need to sing.
Yeah.
But again, post... the recreation of MS, her her music also gets affected somewhere. It's not as, you know, unhindered and bindas the way she sounds
yes.
here.
Yes.
In fact, the archive actually has the very first recording of M.S. Subbulakshmi as a 9-year-old kid. Imagine the place I found that was in a Chor Bazaar in Moor Market in Chennai. So that is where, unfortunately, it lies. And I think we have that in the book. So the book comes with a CD,
yes.
Which has all these tracks that you could hear. I think that track is also there of the first ever recording of Bharat Ratna M.S. Subbulakshmi.
And I thought this was Panthorali, but it's a ragam that I don't know. I was going to ask Vikram who his favorite woman artist was, but I think we all know the answer. And in the interest of allowing you to ask him questions, let me ask Ricky, what are some standouts from this project that you produced, you co-produced?
So, I mean, for me, of course, Gohar Jaan, then Zora Bai, simply because, you know, as you said, a lot of pathos in the voice and, you know, and beautiful, beautiful texture of voice and very skilled singer. So that was probably a complete standout, yeah.
Yeah. So this ragam Shubha Panthvarali is what is usually sung for pathos. But in Carnatic and North in Hindustani, there are parallels. Some don't, but this one I think does. Can we get the last recording, which is 6? And then we will take your questions.
Sitting with her dog in the advertisement of the gramophone company. Yeah. So at least there she gets full points as animal lovers that we are.
Yeah.
So Bangalore Nagaratnam, again, such an understated musician of her times, who of course being, apart from being the great musician that she was, she took on the orthodoxy like no one else did. She came across this very erotic poetry of the Radhika Santvanamu of the Maratha period in Tanjavur. And this had this episode of Krishna and Radha love we've all heard of, but this was a Krishna-Radha love with a twist, where Krishna was shown as someone much younger than a much married, much older Radha.
Mm.
And so first of all, there's age asymmetry, but they both have an affair. And then because there's social pressure, she gets her niece, I think, Ila Devi, married to Krishna. And then she suffers pangs of jealousy every time she sees Krishna and Ila, you know, getting to their bedroom and all of that. And then she demands literally to Krishna, saying, you need to satisfy me as well. And Krishna being Krishna. And there's a lot of abusive words that she uses against him and so on. And finally, he kind of, balances both the women that he has to deal with, the aunt and the niece. So that is why this book itself was titled Radhika Santvanamu, or The Appeasement of Radha. Now, obviously, you can imagine the furore it caused when it was published in 1910. The copies of the book were banned and burnt, and the publishers were hounded and all of that. But she didn't take it lying down. She took it to court. And the case went for several years. The book was banned, of course, before independence. Mm. But after independence, the book came back into circulation and so on. And we know about this Muddu Palani, this Devadasi in Tanjavur, who wrote that book. And also, interestingly, Bangalore Nagaratnamma was the one who found and discovered the Samadhi of Saint Tyagaraja in Tiruvayar. This was a place that was just left where, you know, dogs and others used to, you know, gather and nothing. It was so unkempt. Yeah. She gave her entire life's savings to make a trust. And even today, those who go to these Samadhi there, actually in front of Tyagaraja's Samadhi, you see her sitting in a,
like
in a posture
Hanuman.
Of, sitting there in reverence.
Yeah.
And again, there typically then all the others came over and said, Devadasis cannot perform at the Tyagaraja Samadhi. The lady who actually resurrected the Samadhi, she had to be pushed away. And these people came and they started their, what happens now, the Pancharatna Kritis and all that are sung. So she to challenge that, she said, who are you to tell me not to sing my reverential, you know, gurus' songs? We will create a parallel festival. Mm. And so while the, you know, the things were going on, the official festival, Aradhana, was going on inside, they had another where only Devadasi sang. And on the stage, she said, I am a Devaradiyal. So I am a Devadasi. What will you do about it? So someone like this, you know, stories like this, which, what guts in those times and age where you could give it back to anybody. Obviously, these stories will not be heard, will not be appreciated, and will be suppressed, digested also.
So
but then, yeah, thanks to some small efforts like ours, I think these stories are at least coming out in the public.
And those who think Indians are prudish, we should all read this Muddu Palani's Radhika Santvanam. I've read it and it gives me goosebumps. It's so obviously sexual. It's not even sensual. So we have time, 10 minutes. I think Ravi is our timekeeper. And
I think before we ask the audience, I would certainly be very happy if Mr. Mohandas Pai, who's here, thanks to whom the Archive of Indian Music came into existence, I think if it's only appropriate that he should say something.
Sure, and please share his welcome, music. Sir.
Yeah, you should, You have to show that men also have a voice.
All I can say is that all of us as Indians and inheritors of our civilization have to support our music, our dance, our heritage, because it's something that our forefathers have given to us and we must pass it on to our children. And I urge all of you to participate in this venture and support people like Vikram, Ricky, and others who are working to get this done. And if you do that, we will be able to show our children all the beautiful things and the great work done by people before us. So they will carry on and build on that and do better and make this country much, much better, a great place to stay with a high quality of life. I think that's an ambition that some of us have, and I would urge all of you to support everybody. Thank you.
Please ask questions, and please ask questions.
Would love to hear Kiran Majumdar Shah sing a little bit. Hi. At least we'll get to know another dimension of hers.
Actually, I've got a sore throat. Anyways.
E baju, baju band khul jaye, savariyane, savariyane jaadu dala re. E baju, baju band khul jaye.
Arre wah, shabash. Wow, that's great.
I think all of us musicians, singers in the audience should be very glad that Kiran didn't take to music as a profession, otherwise we would all be out of a job. Vikram and Ricky, congratulations. I'm Manasi Prasad, I'm a musician and the museum director of the Indian Music Experience. Wonderful work, as always, in great admiration. My question is, as you know, we've heard so many of the recordings from your archive, some of them are in our museum as well. I find that a lot of the repertoire also has changed over time. Of course, you heard M.S. Sama Singh Tyagaraja Kritis, but a lot of the compositions themselves have disappeared from what we sing these days. So I wanted your observations on what was that repertoire. I've heard Magalore Nagratama's Nitya Kalyani, all these songs. They aren't heard that much anymore. What happened to them?
Yeah. That's a brilliant question from a brilliant musician. Thank you, Mansi. And so I think the change is more visible, according to me, in Carnatic music, much more than Hindustani music. At least several of these Thumris and Dadras and Chaitis and all of that, and the Khayals, are still in circulation, and of course the whole attempt to rewrite some of that, erase the so-called, erotic content and make it, sanitize it a bit, that was done. But the change, immense change, I would find in the Carnatic, catalogs. In the first few years or the first decade of recording, many of these Carnatic musicians, Selam Godavari, Dhanakoti Ammal of Kanchipuram, and Coimbatore Thai, another superstar, and Bangalore Nagaratnama, all these people, recorded a lot of padams and javalis. As part of my research, I've actually documented these padams and javalis. We don't even have the lyrics of most of them, let alone as students of music, I don't think we've been taught many of these. But I think, interestingly, that's where society and its impact on music, we see that also. Around 1910 was when Nagaratnamma had this case that I was talking about. So till then, she was recording a lot of padams and javalis which have this erotic content to it, the Shringar Bhav. But after that, she becomes perhaps very conscious. So there are only a lot of bhakti and devotional songs being sung. And there's a alarming erasure of the padams and javalis completely from the catalogs after that. And like you mentioned rightly, even the way the kriti was probably sung, that also, as I mentioned in the opening, institutions and so on, which began standardizing music, giving a lot more emphasis on enunciation, on the way it needs to be presented, the Music Academy and several others. One of the projects was also how not to sound like her, and these are documented objectives in these standardization conferences, saying, if our own people start singing, same like what the Devadasi sings, who will then go to her house? They'll perhaps sing, listen among ourselves, and also it should sound so distinct. So this classicism, which we talk about, I think was a very recent construct, and how it sounded. If in 1920 or Coimbatore Thai sang like this, or in 1927 M.S. Amma herself sang like this, that was what was classical then, unless she was being taught a different paradigm of Carnatic music. So the changes for me are very, very sharp and distinct when it comes to Carnatic music. Hindustani somehow still manages to retain, other than words here and there, the texture and the feel of the song and the genre, I think that remains very much the same.
While we wait for the next hand to go up, of course, you both are musicians. His guru has written about Ariyakudi Ramanuja Iyengar changing, coming up, inventing the kacheri format and varnam and so on. And of course, now we have Coke Studio taking Aruna Sairam's padam, Kshetraya padam into Payada Paicheri. Yes. Beautifully done though. Any other questions? Yes.
Vikram Basanti here. I was wondering if the fate of even M.S. Subbulakshmi and her singing as a nine-year-old was in Moor Market, Chennai. Is there a possibility, or what's the kind of range of women musicians who we have lost even without knowing that we have lost, hearing. So what's the sense that you get? And secondly, what's the future of this project of yours?
I think we've lost a lot already. Whatever fragments are available, we're just trying to retrieve and restore those. Interestingly, in the first decade of recording, from 1902 to 1915 or so, 83% to 85% of the recording catalog of classical Indian music, both Hindustani and Carnatic, was of women. 83% to 85%. Very, very few men. Imdad Khan, Ustad Abdul Karim Khan, then Fayaz Khan, and also in our own Mysore, of course, the Mysore Maharaja being so liberal, allowed the palace musicians to record. So Bidaram Krishnappa and Veene Sheshanna and all these people tried to record. But 83% to 85% was of these women, out of which probably 20-30% remains. As I said, others are just names. No one knows who this Kali Jaan of Delhi is, or Kiti Jaan of Meerut, and Achan Bhai of Bombay. They're just names in a catalog. If we're lucky, we probably come across a few records to at least hear the voice and to hear how they announce their name in that joyous, flippant manner. But other than that, I think we've lost a whole lot of all of that. And including, the only record of Mahatma Gandhi on a gramophone disc. He broadcast it for the radio, but for the gramophone, he recorded in 1931 or 32 when he went to London for the roundtable conference. And someone put this one and said, say something. He said, I will not say anything political. I will talk about my conception of God and what God is. And so that is called the spiritual message of Gandhi. So we actually found that in the Chandni Chowk in Delhi, amidst a stack on which the fellow was actually putting his leg and sitting over it. And that is where the father of the nation's voice actually rests. So that is sadly the kind of regard we give for our own past and documentation. The future, I don't know. It depends on a lot of support and help from many people. Many people in your personal collections, you may be having a lot of gramophone records come down from grandmother's, great-grandfather's collection, not knowing now what to do because, as Michael mentioned, you don't have the disc, the player or the needles and all of that. So if any of those are available, I am your glamorized kabadi wala who can collect all of that and probably give it a new lease of life. And Ricky and I have been collaborating not only on gramophone records, but also living forms of music which are going extinct. In this very auditorium a couple of months back, pre-second wave, we had the launch of our documentary film on the bowels of Bengal. So as much as I think the recorded music is on the threat of extinction, I think many of these living traditions of indigenous communities, whom we disparagingly call as tribes and so on, just the Northeast has about 300 plus indigenous communities, each having very distinctive dialects, music, dance forms, instruments, all of that, which we have not documented or saved, let alone give those musicians a source of livelihood to continue the art form and for their children to take up this whole era of globalization. So our effort to actually document just the bowels, we want to do a lot more for that, is also not only to create awareness about these people. So when you say bowel, everyone remembers Parvati Das Bowel, who comes to a studio setting and sings. Nothing wrong in that. But then the actual bowels we met in the sannyasi bowels, who were in Shamshans, in Birbhum and Tarapit and all these places, never coming out, but such fabulous voices and music steeped in that philosophy, to just get those things out, if not for anything, just for the dry reason of documentation and keeping it somewhere, so that 100 years from now, our grandchildren will not say we didn't do enough to restore or preserve these voices.
No, I just wanted to say that, you commented earlier on that why are we so bad at documentation? And I think that is something we really need to focus on and prod our government to really, ensure that every university is, made to teach people to document anything and everything. That should be taught in schools.
Yes.
Documentation is so important, and you're right. That is why even our state of research is so poor in this country, because we don't document.
Yes.
If I may, Ricky and I share a love of wildlife. And just today, a professor at Brown was telling me, vernacular is steeped in context and region. Whereas Latin, Linnae, and taxonomy, the way they name a bird is they skin the bird, send it to a museum in the UK, and they give it a Latin name. Whereas if you talk about a pakshi or a hakki in Karnataka, they will know the behavior and the music and the context of the bird. So I think most cultures that are ancient deal in context, whereas documentation is taking something out of context, which Vikram so beautifully said now with the bowl. So you're removing it from the shamshans and the tarapit, but that is necessary, but that's also taking it out of context. And India is such a contextual culture. Any one last question? Let me, of course, Vasanti, but let me see if anyone else has, of course. Yes, there's one there. Not a man.
I just wanted to understand, how did the commercials of this work for the women who recorded these songs?
Mm. Good question. Don't know.
As in,
were they paid? Yeah,
yeah. Were they paid?
So they used to charge a lot. So when the gramophone company initially came to India, so typically an orientalist view of looking at the country. So Gaisberg also, you know, he's led to all these notch parties in Calcutta, which was the capital of India. And then he's taken to these, you know, theater artists who play to him just to impress the Westerner. They sing badly arranged Western compositions. And he's so frustrated, saying, I want to hear the music of your country, but you're trying to play to me Romeo and Juliet and all of these, you know, kind of things. And he said, he writes with so much disdain that, you know, this is such a crass country. I don't even know why I came here. And I have to forget all the learnings of operas and symphonies and all of that and so on. And so it was a classic case of the East and the West never meeting, where they were not able to understand the, or they didn't care much. It was only commercial. What sold, that's what you'd go for. Then they started sending agents to do market research, saying who's the most popular singers. And lo and behold, these women were some of the more popular you know, singers. And so that's why they patronized them. And these people also knew this business opportunity that came their way. So they said, let's up the price. And because they are, the men are not playing ball to them. And we are the only catch for good music. Otherwise, you'll get these theater artists who will sing bad songs to them. So let's try and negotiate a high price. So 3,000 rupees for one session, 5,000 rupees for one session in those days, which was a huge amount that Gohar Jan and Janki Bai and others would ask for. And they usually would come. So the recording agent, as they were called, they would come for a couple of weeks. And then go across the country. So landing in the capital of Calcutta and then going to the other metro cities, Bombay and Madras. And by then their agents would keep a survey done and keep all the artists in queue saying, you know, on this date, so such and such is coming to the studio and so on. So in a day-long session or a five-day session, they would probably record 150 masters, all 333 minutes each. And they would also have very, interestingly, agents who, in fact, as part of my PhD research, also have done work on that, as to someone like a Selam Godavari, who was a Devadasi, very astute lady. So she would appoint agents, male agents, who would know a little bit of English, and they would go and keep telling the recording agent, you know, it sounds very nice, right? It's very good. This is actually, she's singing very well. And then, in fact, in the middle of the recording, there's suddenly a male voice which says, "Bale, bale, shabash, shabash." So that's actually the agent, actually, you know, commenting on that and saying, "I think she deserves more salary, you know, remuneration." So many of those recording agents talk about with a lot of irritation, saying, "You know, you have these. The women are okay." About them also, they had this fascination that they all came dressed in so much of finery to the studio, thinking it's a live performance, little realizing that they were singing to a bland horn, which didn't see them. And incidentally, whenever the agent said, "Can we photograph you?" they would remove all the jewels and then pose for the photograph, apparently. So to appear probably very poor or whatever. And these agents would come along with them and try to strike deals. And many of these recording experts in their experiences and memoirs, they said the women are great, but their male agents who come along with them are so irksome because they're all the time negotiating for higher price and we don't understand the music. So they keep saying, that was a very good phrase. That was a very nice thing. It will be very popular. Many people will hear it and so on. So I think that's how the economics of the early recording industry perhaps worked.
So Ricky is a magnificent performer, and I think, tell me if you agree with it, today's magical moment was when you asked Kiran to sing, and we were all thinking, will she, won't she, will she, won't she, and then she did. That's the magic of a live performance, and we all got it today. I want to end with asking Ricky a question and thanking Vikram for being the glorified kabaddi wala that you claim you are, and thanking Kiran for her song. But Ricky, let's end with a question. So what next? Now it's all cloud recordings. Now where will music go next?
So first of all, I mean that if I can take a minute to just respond to what Vikram said just now.
Of course.
So the thing is that it's very interesting because, I mean, just some thoughts going on in my mind while Vikram was talking, during those times, these women understood that being a musician was not just being a musician, you also had to be an entrepreneur. And in today's world, musicians understand that, and artists understand that, you know, that you not only have to be an artist, but you have to understand how to sell the art. And the way to sell the art is that you have to sell yourself, and you have to sort of have a persona. So I can tell you this one thing that happened to me. You know, I was in a record label office waiting for an interview in Mumbai, and there was this other guy who was with me, a really, really popular mainstream Bollywood singer, won't name him, but he got very candid with me because we had some time together. And to give you context, you may guess who he is, but he has an elder brother who is a very popular singer. And he's telling me that his elder brother did not help him out at all. And so he came to Bombay and he was completely penniless. And he barely had any money, and whatever little bit money he used to make, he would not eat with it. He would basically, and he would sleep on his friend's couch, and he did not have a home. So he did not have money for food, for home or whatever. He would put all his money into renting a Hummer. Okay, a yellow color Hummer and four bodyguards. And what he would do is that every time he would go to a record label office or a radio station office or whatever, he would get, like, you know, these bodyguards to sweep the office, and then, you know, and his Hummer would come up in the front porch, and then he would get out, and, you know, and he would do his meetings and all of that stuff. Because he said that the persona was extremely important, and he said that those initial years of just manufacturing that persona is what helped him to become one of the more popular singers in India. And now, of course, he's a millionaire and he's making a lot of money. But that's, it's amazing to know that these women understood that, because nowadays a lot of musicians are very delusional, that they feel that, you know, that I can just do my music and if it's good music, people will listen to it. But that's not the way it is, you know. The way it is that, like, you know, you really need to be an entrepreneur, you need to be able to command a fee, and you need to be able to sell yourself really well and market yourself really well. Now, about the book itself, about where it goes, I just wanted to tell you about that. First of all, very grateful that Vikram and I collaborated. And for those of you who know me personally, you know that I speak really fast and I've got a very short attention span. And, you know, and basically I used to have a learning disorder in school and all of that stuff. But the thing is that I do not read books. So that's something that I would admit, that I do not read books. And that's something that, you know, Vikram, one of my closest friends, writes books, and I don't read most of his books because there are no pictures in the books. So that is why I insisted that this book has to have pictures on every single page, you know, because only then I'll be able to read it myself. So we did like a photo shoot, and we made the book very colorful and with large font and all of that stuff, just so that I could read it. And I absolutely love the book, and I think Vikram is a great writer. So the book costs about, I think, 1,000 rupees, and it's available at a 20% discount outside at, yeah, book with a CD with all the music that you heard. So with Michael Graves mastering finesse. And the book is available outside, and you can just purchase that if you'd like. And where does music go? We musicians are going to keep evolving. That's the way it is. With the pandemic, you know, a whole lot of our revenue streams got cancelled out. But everybody got creative, and people are going to get more and more creative. So the fact is that music and for musicians to express themselves, that's never going to stop. But the medium will continue to change, whether it's cassettes, CDs, whether it is streaming, whether it is cloud or whatever. So we are going to constantly express ourselves. Music will never die, but the medium of reaching out to our audiences is going to constantly evolve and constantly change. Yeah.
So thank you, Ricky, Vikram, and Kiran.
I'll be extremely failing in my duty if I didn't acknowledge two people whom everybody can blame for whatever I am today, and for the series of books I've inflicted on all of you. And that's Miss Aditi Vashishtha, who's my principal from Sri Aurobindo Memorial School, where I grew up right from kindergarten to class 10. And interestingly, my history teacher, who's here, Ms. Jayashree Ravindra. I'm not sure if she ever imagined that this boy who would get rather punished quite often in history classes, because I just couldn't memorize dates and who succeeded whom and what war and all of those frivolous details we are taught. One day he'll actually be termed as a historian in India. So thanks to both of you for this. Thank you.
It only goes to show how much potential there is in every child. Don't go by the appearance. But there is a tremendous...
I don't know if that was a compliment or anything.
Our Vikram, as a young little boy, you know, with curly strong, thicky hair, eyes were always running here and there. And he was light on his feet. And we teachers insist that children should listen to us attentively. Today I have listened to him mesmerized. Now this is learning. Now when I go to a classroom and see children sitting, I don't know where there are those diamonds that will come out brilliant and dazzling and serve society and bring hidden things out. Now this is something great. And Vikram is absolutely wonderful. He lives in my heart. I'm mighty proud of him. And it makes me love all the children in the school even more. Seeing you. Because I was listening to you mesmerized.
Thank you, madam. Thank you. And thank you all for being a wonderful audience, asking such great questions. Like to borrow Ravi's line, there is you need a gate pass to get out, and that is please buy a copy of the book.
And Vikram looks just how he was then, only grown taller.
And the other thing I must mention while we're doing the pose, Kiran, you saved us, because the write-up today says there's going to be live singing. And I was wondering, where's the live singing coming? So BIC still continues to hold its credibility. Thank you. Thanks, everybody. Thanks, everybody. Been a fine audience, and the books are available as you go out.